And so today, what I'm going to share with you is something that when Quantrill told me we're doing this, and I was going to, my day would be Sunday, and I began to inquire the Lord, well, Lord, what do you want me to teach on? And anything come right away. But as I sit there and I thought about it and, you know, kind of went on about my business, and maybe a little while later, the Lord says, teach on the corporate structure of the family. So we're going to look at the corporate structure of how the family is designed to function. Now, I'm going to tell you right up front, this is not going to be a particular popular message for the modernists. You know, people that want to plug into, that's just outdated. You know, this is, we live in a modern society. Okay, well, you keep on with your modern society. And when I look at the statistics of the divorce rate in modern society, it don't look that good. So obviously something's wrong. And so what I want to share with you this morning is, what does God have to say about it? Now, let me ask you a question before we get into the Word. How many of you believe that God's Word is right? Amen. Let me see a hand. I want to see a hand this morning, because I'm setting you up. I am setting you up for where we're going. And if your hand went up in the air and you said you believe God's Word is right, then what I'm going to share with you this morning is right. Amen. All right? And I am setting you up because I'm just going to let you know, because we got to change some things. Amen. Now, let's go to Romans chapter 12, and we'll start here, because if we do not start to think back in line with what God said about certain things, or everything, then we're going to continue to reap the same harvest that you see going on in the world today. Now, in Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2, we know these scriptures very well. Verse 1 says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Now, when I read this scripture, and I know he's talking to born-again believers here, but listen to this and follow me for a second here. You can't present your body until you have surrendered. So when I read verse 1, I hear God saying, hey, get born again. Give me your life. Submit your life unto me. Make a sacrifice out of your life and dedicate it to me. Then verse 2 tells you what you need to do after you get born again. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you might prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. It's not enough just to get saved. Now that you're saved, you're going to have to renew your mind so that you can begin to understand for your own self what God's perfect will is for you. See, we got a lot of people that just get born again and think that they're finished, and then you continue to try to live like you lived before you got saved. The two don't match. There has to be a renewing that takes place, because the only information that's in there is the information you received from the world you were living in. But the problem with that world you were living in, it was governed, controlled by Satan. And it is absolutely 100% opposite of God's system and way of doing things. So this is why the Word of God says that you have to allow your mind to be renewed through the Word of God so that you for yourself can begin to see what's right. And then it goes on to verse 3 and it says, here's how. You do it by faith. For God has dealt to every man what? The measure of faith. So three things we see already. Number one, you're going to have to be born again. The moment I get born again simply means now I've changed kingdoms. Amen. I'm no longer living for this one. I'm living in this one now. Amen. Which means if I switch systems, there's a whole nother operation that needs to go on. Amen. Now, in order for me to learn that operation, number two is I have to get my mind renewed, which says that I cannot continue to do it the way that I used to do it. If you switch systems, then you have a whole nother new set of rules to be governed by, right? Now, if that's true, then that would be, if it's true when it comes to salvation, if it's true when it comes to deliverance, amen. If it's true when it comes to everything else, then it's true when it comes to marriage and family. God has a structure. The problem is that the modern day society has thrown God's structure out because it deems it outdated. Amen. But my Bible said, God says that he knows the end from the beginning, and he changes not. So whatever he set up in the beginning will work at the end, just as good as it did in the beginning. Yes. Amen? So today we're going to look at this. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, it's going to be a little different than what you probably are used to. I remember when God first gave me this, Quantrell and I were struggling in our marriage, and I remember they said, I was a deacon then. Deacon Brown, was it a young people service? It was a young people service. And so we had the young people, and God said, I was going to get to preach on a Sunday evening. And that was an honor. And so I'm getting ready to preach. You know, it's not just teenagers here, grown folks, pastors. There's going to be a whole bunch of folks in here now. And here I am, 22, 23 years old, getting ready now to have to preach something to this congregation of people. So I'm looking in the Bible, trying to find something to teach, you know, and the Lord's beginning to deal with me. I'm like, well, deal with me on this. And I'm like, well, Lord Jesus, I only been married for a few years, and I ain't all right. How am I going to preach this? And I preached it. And God taught me some things when I preached it. And this man came up to me afterwards, Davis, Minister Davis, came up to me after. He's a, you know, seasoned man in the Word. Been evangelizing for a long time. He says, son, I'm going to tell you right now. He says, you preach what you preach tonight, I know God gave it to you because it's well beyond your years. Yes. He says, I sit there and I watched you. He says, God kept showing me you, and it's like you standing there. He said, I saw you standing there in a suit that was like extremely way too big for you. In other words, what I was sharing was way beyond what I could have known. There was no way for me to know it. Hadn't been married that long, didn't come from a Christian family, but God was teaching me something then, and I'm telling you now, it has helped me down through the years. Quantrell and I have not gotten to the place that we've gotten at after 23 years of being married. We have not gotten to this place that we are by chance and trial and error. It has been on purpose, doing it the way God said do it. So if you have your Bibles, and I know you do, let's get into this. Let's go to the perfect will of God. Genesis chapter 1. God's perfect will, how he started this thing. All right? So now let's look in Genesis chapter 1. And let's look at the format. I'm going to do this in two different ways here. I'm going to start out and I'm going to give you the structure. Then I'm going to go back and show you how the structure should operate. So, now, Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. And God said, let us make man in our image, and after our likeness, and let them. So that is a key right there that he's not just talking about the male species. He says, let us make man in our image, and after our likeness, and let them have dominion, authority, over all the fish of the sea, over all the fowl of the air, and over all the cattle, and over all the earth, and over everything that creepeth up on the earth. Verse 27, so God created man in his own image. Now he's getting ready to identify who the them are. Because the modern people read this book and say, well, God was chauvinist. He's only talking to the men. He never has really anything good to say about the women. So they go back, well, they went back through the Bible and reworked stuff and rewrote stuff to make it sound more favorable for women. When they didn't understand that when God speaks, God's not speaking to a single group. God's speaking to humanity. Amen. So now he's going to identify for you and I who the them are. So God created man in his own image, and in the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. So who has dominion? Male and female. Who has authority? Male and female. I'm establishing something here. Because for some strange reason, Satan has convinced society that men and women, but that a man is superior to a woman. And I'm here this morning to tell you that's not so.
Amen.
They are equal. We're equal. Because God says, let them. When he said, let man have dominion, let them, male and female, have dominion.
Amen.
So that means my wife is just as anointed as I am. She carries, when it comes to spiritual authority in the kingdom of God, she is just as equipped as I am. No less, no more.
Amen.
Because we are all functioning underneath God's anointing.
Yes.
And God didn't give me some and give her a little and give me more than her, or didn't give her more than me and give me less than her. No, we're equal.
Amen.
We have to be equal. And you're going to see this as we go through here. And then he says, and God blessed them. So not only did he give male and female authority, he empowered both of them.
Amen.
Empowered them to do what? To walk in this level of dominion that he said belongs to us. So I wanted to start there first. Because it has to be established in our hearts and in our minds. And I'm praying the Holy Spirit allows you to track this along with me this morning. That your wife, husbands, are just as anointed as you are, just as powerful as you are, just as capable as you are, and wives, your husband aren't children. They are anointed men of God, and they are just as anointed as you are, just as powerful as you are, and have the same authority and dominion rights. We're equal. All right? So now that we see that, let's get into the structure of the and the responsibility. Because the difference isn't in our ability to walk in authority. That's not where the difference is. We're both anointed. The difference is in the operation of the anointing. Then you will find the difference. But it's not less than the other. I'm trying to establish this morning, because if you're not careful, you'll fall underneath the same lie that society is walking under, and you'll start trying to dictate out who's supposed to be in charge and who's not, and who's the boss and who's not. And when I read my word, God didn't call anyone bosses.
Amen.
Nobody's a boss.
Amen.
We all have responsibilities. So now let's look at Genesis chapter 2. So now in this, we're going to find the breakdown. Now, the reason I'm reading starting here, because this is the perfect will of God. This is before any sin or anything of acts of sin, contaminations were found. Nothing was found wrong. This is God's perfect will. Genesis chapter 2, verse 16. Well, let's start at verse 15. And the Lord God took the man, the male, the man, and he put him in the garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it.
Amen.
So now what is God establishing? He's establishing roles and responsibility. All right? So now we're talking about the man, the male, the man. God took him, set him in the garden, and his responsibility was to dress it and keep it. In other words, he was supposed to work and protect. In short, that's what we're saying here. He's supposed to work and protect. Verse 16. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. So now, in those few verses of scriptures, we've gotten the responsibility for the man. He is the leader by design. He is the leader of the family by design. The anointing that is on him equips him to lead, to help God provide and protect. He is anointed to do that because God established it. Eve is not even on the scene yet. God is talking 100% to this man. Not only was he anointed to lead, help God provide and protect, God gave him the responsibility of communicating the vision for the family. Because God told him, God gave him the words. This tree, don't you eat from this tree. For in the day that you make a decision to eat from this tree, you will surely die. Now, Eve's not hearing this. Adam is. God is communicating to this man his will. The man is receiving direction from God for his family. And it is his responsibility to make sure that he hears it correctly and that he communicates it correctly. So not only does he have the responsibility to lead, he is also responsible for helping God provide, protect, and to communicate God's perfect will for his family. God's establishing this. Now that's important for where we're going. And men, whether you like it or not, that is your mandate. You are responsible for it, and you are going to give an account for it. Because you are equipped to do it whether you believe you are or not. One of the things the Lord told me about this is that the man is the foundation for the family. Now, when you think about the foundation, because I used to get a little upset. You know, I used to get a little upset when Mother's Day come out. It's like 15,000 commercials on TV. The store is lit up with all of the women's stuff, and everybody's mama, 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 mama. Father's Day comes, it's a whisper. And I used to didn't understand that. And am I lying? You know I'm not lying. It's not the big, you know, they may say a few things, but it's not like Mama's Day. And so I began to like get a little upset, and the Lord had to correct me on something. And I'm gonna, let me show you what share with you what he shared with me. He says, when a house is built, when is the only time you see the foundation of a house? I said, well, I got to thinking. I said, when they're building it. And he says, once the house is built, you never see it again. You never hear from it again. The only time you ever hear someone talk about the foundation of the house once the house has been built is if what? Something's wrong. It's the only time you'll hear about it again. In other words, God was telling me, if you're not hearing anything about your foundation, things are working properly. Because if you start hearing about the foundation, that's a telltale sign that something is wrong with the foundation. Amen. And then he said, when you walk into a house, nobody goes talking about, whoo, look at this foundation. Girl, did you see the foundation? Isn't that a beautiful foundation? That is the best foundation I ever seen. No one says that. They talk about the windows. They talk about the counters. They talk about the bathroom. They talk about everything else. Why? Because that's what you see. So this is why Mama's Day is more celebrated than Father's Day. Well, not more celebrated, but why you hear more about it. Stop being upset about that. Because if you're doing, and this is what he said to me, if you have to consistently insert your manhood into the equation, then that is a sign that your foundation is broke. Because if your foundation was correct, you would never have to tell anyone who you were. They already know. Isn't that true? You find a good house? Matter of fact, a lot of times when people are serious home searchers and home builders and people are serious about houses, most of them will tell you they would rather find an older house and remodel because they know the foundations were built good back then. They seek them out. But let me get off, because I can spend a whole lot of time on that and I want to. So we see God establishing here the responsibility of the man. Then we read here, verse 18, and the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helpmate for him. The Amplified Bible says, I will make him a helpmate, someone that is suitable, someone that will be adapted and complementary for him. So now we see the responsibility of the man, help provide, help protect, provide leadership for the family. Here comes the wife. She doesn't come on the scene until after God has established the man. Herein is why you need to get up out your mama's house and off your mama's couch and get established. But I'm not going to go into that because I got something else to say. So, God, after he's established the responsibility of the leader, he now brings the people that he's going to lead into existence. And Eve's job was not to lead. Her job is to be a helpmate. Now, herein is why she has to be have the same level of anointing, same level of authority, same level of dominion that Adam did. Because if she did not, she can't help him. You got to see that. Someone lesser than you can't assist you. In order for you to be a help to me, we have to be on equal playing fields. In other words, I got to be able to trust that you can handle what needs to be handled. You have to have the same level of ability that I do, or you can't help me. Amen. This is why God established that first. Them are blessed. Them are anointed. Them are empowered. Both of you are anointed. It's just a difference in the operation. So Adam's job, leader. Eve's job, helpmate. Got to get this. We're going somewhere with it. Now, the problem with this is that the modern ear hears subservient. Helpmate, I'm a slayer. He ain't my daddy. He ain't my boss. I'm not going to bow down. I'm just not going to be a housewife. And what is all this? See, the problem is that God's people have allowed the world to train their thinking when it comes to the family. And we're willing to shift in everything else but that. Because everybody's too busy trying to protect their position in the family, and you're rather protect your position of being right than being happy. And God told me that. He says, would you rather be right or rather be happy? And I made a decision, I'd rather be happy, then you're gonna have to do it my way. Quit trying to protect your position and honor my word, and I'll make you happy.
That's all right now.
I'm trying to help you this morning. I'm trying to shift thinking this morning. I'm trying to get us off of the world system of operation when it comes to marriage and the family and get us back on God's track, because his is right. And all y'all raised your hand and said, yeah, Pastor, I believe the word was right. Well, hopefully you still agree with me when we're done. All right. So we got this established now. Now, here's what God showed me back all those years ago. In the realm of the spirit, God doesn't pay attention to, you know, to the marriage structure the way that we do. When God looks at the marriage, he's looking at what he created. He's looking at headship, helpmate, offspring.
It's all right now.
Headship, helpmate, offspring. And this is what the Lord told me. In the position of headship and helpmate, the platform that's there is only designed for one person to stand on at a time. Two people can't stand on the platform. One has to be there. And it's designed that the man stand on the platform of headship or leader because he was anointed to do that. It's designed for the woman to stand on the platform of helpmate because she's anointed to do that. Yeah. Now, the platform of the children and offspring, we get multiple there simply because of the way it is designed. I'm going to show it to you. But these first two, only one person can occupy the space at a time. And each one of those platforms come with characteristics. All right? The headship comes with characteristics. Leadership, authority to lead the family, to operate in that. The helpmate comes with characteristics, to submit to what the leader is saying do. Now, don't let me lose you there, ladies, because that is a powerful position. I'm going to show it to you after a while. But what I'm trying to establish right now is the structure. Now, well, Pastor, where you get that from? You're just making that up. All right, well, let's establish it, because I'm not making anything up. I'm going to give you the word this morning, because you're not going to argue with me. It's the book. That's why I asked you, did you agree with this book? Because I'm telling you right now, the Bible says the word of the Lord is perfect. It's already been tested. It's already been tried. It works for anyone that will work it. But you got to agree with it. Now, watch this. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Let me establish these positions, these platforms. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 3. But I would have you know. Notice, here's what you need to know. That the head of every man, the head of every man is Christ. So everybody has an order in this structure. The head of every man is Christ. And the head of every woman is the man. And the head of Christ is God. So God just gave you the corporate structure in the kingdom. God's running the show. He's the head. Then there's Christ. Then there's the man. Then there's the man. And then there is the woman. And then there are the children. So who did God say is the head? The man. Simply mean, he's the leader here. And there is a reason God designed it this way. And I'm telling you right now, men, if you're in this room, you are anointed to lead. Whether you think so or not. And wives, you need to get off the platform of headship and let your husbands get there. That's why your family's jacked up. I'm going to hit you with some stuff this morning. You may not like it, but it's true. God said they're the head. And the head comes with responsibility. What was it? I just got to explain to you, they're the leader. We went through all that. The characteristics is leadership, dominance. Not dominating your family, but dominance in the kingdom of God, dominance in the realm of the spirit. You're leading, you're taking charge, you're out there battling the headwinds for your family. So the man's the head. Now, the woman, helpmate. Let's go to Proverbs. I'm going to show you something here. Proverbs chapter 14. Now we're talking about the position of helpmate. The position of helpmate. Well, let me just read it. Proverbs 14, verse 1 says, Every wise woman builds her house, but the foolish pluck it down with her own hands. Let me read that from a couple of other translations. Here's one, a Good News translation. Homes are made by the wisdom of a woman, but are destroyed by foolishness. Here's another one. Homes are, the wisest woman builds up her house, but the stupid one tears it down with her own hands. That came out of the God's Word translation. Help mate. What are you helping to do? Build your house. See, the anointing that is on that woman is an anointing to build, to help build that house. The man is an establisher. He establishes what's going on. That's what the foundation does. But all the other structures is actually the building of the house. In other words, man's anointing is to lead, dominate for the family. Woman's anointing is to influence everything that the man establishes. But the man can't establish anything until he gets his direction from who? God. So God gives the directions to the man. The man is supposed to communicate that to the family, right? Because Eve wasn't on the scene when God gave out direction. It was the man's job to communicate the vision to the family. And then the woman who is the receiver receives it, and through her anointing of able to influence how it's built, begins to go to work. And a wise woman builds her house, and it says a stupid one tears it down with her own hands. Now, back to the platforms. Each platform, only one person can stand on at a time. So as the husband stands on his platform as the head, the anointing to lead his family is operating. Dominance, authority. This is why back in the day, the mama, all she had to say is, when your daddy get home, we're gonna find out. And a hush came over the house. Why? Because that's authority coming home. Yes. It's gone now. Yeah. I'm going to show you why. Mama was able to hear daddy say, hey, boy, this is what we're going to do, and it's going to be like this, and we're going to get this straight in this house. And mama could come right on around the corner. All right, now you heard what your daddy said. Now here's how we're going to do it. She didn't tear down what daddy says. She begins to build it. She's anointed to do it. And can get it done. I heard Marlon Monroe say this, and I didn't understand it then, but I get it now. He says when God is trying to establish something hard, when God was trying to establish something hard in his church, he said he would communicate that to his wife and then let his wife stand up and talk. He says, because you begin to understand what I'm talking to you today about, the anointing of an influencer. Oh, women, if you could ever get that in your head and understand you're not being walked upon, get in your role and function. Oh my God, your power. You tap into who you are, what you're created to do. Now, when they get off, is where problems show up. When the wife makes a decision, I'm going to stand on the headship platform. Now, if there's a husband in the house, remember, only one can stand there at a time. So when the wife makes a decision to occupy the headship platform and the man allows it, he has to step down because only one can stand there at a time. But once he steps down, he loses all of the operations and functions of that position, and he steps down into the other one. Get it? Because headship don't, hey, all the characteristics of headship don't step down with him. They stay with the platform. Yes, they do. Here's why when you see women that are running their house, they're controlling, they're dominant, they're hard, and the men's, yes, ma'am, okay. I know, it might sound funny, but you know it's right. Am I lying?
That's right, Daddy.
We were on a cruise. We were on a cruise, me and Quantrill. It was a 5-day cruise. First day, I saw this man. Now, ain't nothing wrong with this if you're helping your wife out. I saw this man holding his wife's purse. Okay, you hold your wife's purse, nothing wrong with that. 5-day cruise. Every time I saw this man, the whole time we were there, he had his wife's purse strapped on. She, hold this. I'm looking at it, hold this. Wait, man, what? See, they don't shift. Positions don't shift. See, if you're paying attention, you know what you're looking at, you see it. I'm gonna prove this to you from the word, though. I'm not sure. I'm gonna prove this to you. You cannot, men, you cannot retain your dominant authority that comes with that position once you step down. It stays there. And wives, you can't retain the influencing anointing position and characteristics when you step up. They don't exchange. Well, where'd you get that from, Pastor? Go back to Genesis chapter 2. We'll look at the scriptures. Well, before you do that, go over to more. I think this would make more sense. Mark chapter 3 first. Let me show you something. You know, I would say, you know, what Jesse Plins them say when they preach, you don't send me no ugly letters. Well, I see this on the YouTube, but y'all know where I live, so I don't even worry about it. But if you're mad, it's still right. Mark chapter 3, rather. I think that's where we're going. Let me find out where we're going. I know where we're supposed to be going. Maybe I didn't see it. Yeah. Mark chapter 3. Look at verse 24. The end of verse 23 says, how can Satan cast out Satan? And if a kingdom be divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. Let's change that word kingdom to family, house. If a house be divided against itself, it can't stand. Verse 25, and if a house be divided against itself, that house cannot stand. Verse 26, and if Satan rises up against himself and be divided, he cannot stand, but he comes to an end. So a house is divided against itself, can't stand, and when the controlling factors in the house rise up against itself, you're going to come to an end. End of what? The structure's just ended. That means everything, the blessing of marriage, the blessing of family, you've just stopped. Notice what it says, 27. No man can enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods, except he will first bind the strong man, and then he will spoil the house. The strong man is supposed to be that husband standing on his platform. But the devil understands, if I'm going to get in here and tear up the goods are your children and all your possessions. If he's going to get in here and spoil your goods, he first has to get that man off. Yes, yes, he does. Because that's the authority in the house. Yes. I got to shut him down by any means necessary. And men, when you don't know who you are and you don't know where you're supposed to be standing and why you're supposed to be there, you will bow your knee and you will step down from your position. And once that has happened, your house is getting ready to be spoiled because your wife cannot support what needs to be supported in that position, although she may be trying to stand there. Right. She can't do it. She's not anointed to, not equipped to do it. She's equipped to assist. She's equipped to help you build. But she is not equipped to lead that house. Oh, Pastor, now you're messing up now. You mean to tell me if he don't ran out on me and I can't leave my house? No. The woman was never supposed to ever stand on the headship platform. Well, what if I don't have a husband? Quantra quote the scripture for you on Friday. God says, I am the Lord your God, and I'll be your husband. He said, if your husband, if there's no man there, I will occupy that platform until he shows up. But you are not supposed to get on it because you can't handle what goes on there. You're not equipped to. You are never to step up there. You're to submit to the headship of the Lord Jesus Christ until your husband is established. This is God's structure, not mine. What you trying to say? I can't handle it. I'm stupid. I'm dumb. It has nothing to do with whether you're stupid, dumb, or any of that. It has everything to do with what did God say was right. He knows why. This is why you got women that are stressed out, they're mean, they're dominant, their kids all jacked up, and the son don't want a woman, and he runs most of the time trying to look for another man, and then the girls, they mad, and then they end up with some strange things, all this strange stuff going on. Why? Because the house is being spoiled.
Amen. That's right. That's all right.
Because everybody's out of place. Folks, I ain't been married for 23 years and I ain't learned something. Now, Genesis. Let me prove it all out to you. Oh, it's in there. You got to know what you're looking at. You got to know what you're paying attention to, but it's in there. Let me read this for you again. Genesis chapter 2. Verse 16, and the Lord God commanded the man. He commanded the man. Saying, every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat. But the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat thereof, for in the day that you eat thereof you shall surely die. God commanded the man. He gave the instructions to the man. The man clearly understood what God said. Adam was operating in 100% capacity of his mental, spiritual, mental, and physical capacities. There was no confusion on what God said here. He knew it and completely understood it. Chapter 3. Now the serpent was more subtle than any of the beasts of the fields which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman. Why is he talking to the woman? We're getting ready to see some stuff here. She's not the head, but that's who he's talking to. She's not supposed to be. Yay, God has said, you shall not eat of any tree of the garden. And the woman said unto the serpent, why is she talking? Hold on, wait just 1 second. First of all, well, I'll get there. So she says, we may freely eat the fruit of the trees of the garden, but the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God said, you should not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. And the serpent said to the woman, you shall surely not die. For God does know that in the day that you eat thereof, your eyes shall be opened, and you shall be as gods, knowing the difference between good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eye, and the tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit and did eat and gave also unto her husband who was with her. Now, let's establish what has happened here. Somewhere in the passing of time here, Adam stopped doing his job. Who did God give instruction to? Adam. But when the serpent started talking, who took up the conversation? Eve. But here's the problem. She messed up the vision. God said don't eat. She said don't eat or touch. It wasn't her fault. She wasn't there. How come she didn't know exactly what God said? Somewhere Adam didn't do his job. See, the enemy is trying to dethrone Adam to spoil some goods here. Wow. And he has to be cunning in how he does it. So he's approaching that woman because and I'm going to show you something. And she takes up the conversation and eats what God said not to eat. But notice, nothing happens yet. Now, here's what God showed me a long time ago, and it just kind of just shocked me. There had been a shift in platform stance because the helpmate platform has to submit to the headship platform, right? What did it say? And she turned and gave to her husband who was with her, and he did submit and eat. Somehow this thing shifted. Eve is standing here instructing him. And he's supposed to know better. But remember, it doesn't shift. It doesn't transfer. Once you step down, it doesn't transfer. You step into what goes with that platform. So when she turned and said, here, eat. But now it's all over with. It's divided against itself, and now some things are getting ready to end. Now, how do I know that's true? Because if you read the story, the Bible says in the next verse, and when God showed up the next day, he said, Adam, where are you? Now, do you think God was missing Adam hiding behind a bush or a tree? Seriously? He couldn't find, well, I can't find Adam. Maybe he's behind the tree over here. Let me go look. You think that's what he was saying? No. He's saying, when I come to the position of leadership, headship, where you're supposed to be, I'm not finding you, I'm finding Eve. I'm coming to talk to the leader here, and I keep finding the helpmate. Where are you, Adam? Why aren't you where I designed for you to stand? Why aren't you up here leading your family? Why aren't you up here communicating this vision correctly? How is it that this thing has gotten into this family and caused all this mayhem? Where are you, Adam? Why aren't you in your position fulfilling your role and your responsibility as the head? I anointed you to dress and to keep this garden. Now it's lost. Now it's lost. And this is what you see going on in society right now. Because Christian households have succumbed to the idea of the world. But when you think like the world, operate like the world, and do like the world, you get what the world gets. This is why the divorce rate in the church is either the same or even higher than it is in the world. And it shouldn't be. Because you don't, husband, head, you don't buy into the lie. This is why you can't listen to society and tell you how to be. You don't buy into the lie. It used to be, you know, you be the man of your house, you go out, you work, and you provide for your family. Then they says, well, you know what? Men, you're just too doggone dominant. You need to get in touch with your feminine self. What feminine self? I don't have a feminine self. I wasn't designed to have a feminine self. I was designed to be a leader. I was designed to stay on this platform. I was designed to be a man. I was designed to dominate. What feminine self are you talking about? See, that's the lie that the devil put in there to get you off your platform. Now I'm going to be a stay-at-home dad. Where can I find that in the Word of God? I'm just saying, I know, I'm just saying. Now women are out trying to be the provider for the house, trying to lead the house, and bro at home playing video game.
It's all right now.
Don't worry, baby, I'll make sure you have something to eat when you get here. What you talking, mate, what? Now, I don't say much, but I probably would slap the spit out of Tiana's mouth if she married somebody like that. I probably would. Yeah, you lost your mind? When did you ever see me do that in the house? Nah. This is why our daughters can't find the right husbands because they ain't seen one. And our sons don't know how to be leaders because they haven't seen one. Because everybody's selfish, want to do their own thing. I'm going to do me. Ain't no such thing as doing me when you get married. Me is over. Amen. What are you talking about? I'm just going to do me. You do you. That when we get married. We're going to do us now. What are you talking about? Me and you. Ain't no me and you. Me and you. See, that tell me right there that you ain't ready. Me and you should have never gotten said. Me and you should have never said I do. Ever. Because you weren't ready. Because there's no such thing as me and you when we get married. There's us. Amen. What happens to you happens to me. What happens to me happens to you. We're in this thing together. I'm going to do me. And that's some stupidest stuff, see? But that's why okay. So what we see here in that scripture, something happened. But look what it cost them. They lost their kids. One son killed the other one. And then the other one ended up just roaming earth. Lost. Whose fault was it? Adam's. Lost their house because God kicked them out of the garden. Had to go. Whose fault was it? Adam's. They lost their lost their empowerment, the blessing. Whose fault was it? Adam's. Wasn't his fault. She wasn't standing there when God was giving out the vision for the family. That's why when you read over read later on in the New Testament, it says she was deceived, but Adam wasn't. Adam wasn't deceived, but he was on the wrong platform. He had to submit. Because he chose to stand someplace that God didn't instruct him to. So, now we've established the corporate structure. That's the structure, folks, whether you like it or not, it's the structure. Yeah. Man, you're supposed to be on a headship platform. Wife, you're supposed to be that helpmate, and then there's the offsprings. If it's not that way, it is out of order, and it is going to be perverted, and is going to be spoiled. I don't care what you say. I don't care how you feel about it. I don't care what you think. You cannot undo what God has said. Amen. Impossible. And when you look into family right now, you see the results of the structure being manipulated or just simply not in place. Well, Pastor, you know, as a wife, I don't know if I agree with that, because that just seems like I'm putting myself in a position to get abused and get walked over. I just don't know, you know. I just don't know if I can do that, because he ain't gonna be my boss. He ain't my daddy. I mean, it's all the things you hear. That's what you hear wives and women saying. I'm going to get my own job, make my own money. I don't need no man. See, you're lying. You're lying to yourself. You're lying. Yeah. I don't need no man. Then, Jesus. You sit up here talking about you're going to get your own money. You don't even need no man. But you end up in some man's bed. Or some man ends up in yours. If you didn't need no man, then why is he in your bed? No, it's because you need somebody. You need them. See, that's you. The problem is you've bought into the lie. And I get it. Brothers ain't doing that job. Brothers too busy running around still acting like they 17. You know, I was talking to a woman a little while ago. And she was like, I don't understand this whole strip club mentality. I do. You got a bunch of men still acting like little kids. That's why they go there. Where do little kids go? They go to the playground to play. Isn't that where they go? That's where the strip club is, a playground for them to go play. This is why you don't marry without prayer. You don't marry without consulting the Holy Ghost, male or female. You better know what you're doing. This ain't no game. This is why God said, don't marry Christian woman, Christian man. Don't marry an unsaved one. Because this structure that I'm talking about right here is not going to be in place. And it's going to cause some problem. I don't care everyone. I don't care how smart you are, woman, how intelligent you are, there's going to be some problems. There's going to be some problems. Remember that commercial, I could bring home the bacon fried up in the pan? That was all 100% Satan. Trying to shift those. It's all about shifting mindsets away from God and His structure. I know I'm taking some time this morning, but I'm finishing this. Whether the CD go off, the tape go off, the film go off, I don't care. We're going to get this in this morning. And if you got to go, just put your little finger up like this, and there's the door over there. All right. So now, so now we get the structure. Now, how does it work? Because it would be wrong for God to give you the structure if He didn't give you how the structure should be operated. And it's in there. All right? So go with me to Colossians chapter 3. Let me tell you something. Well, let me read this and then we'll get to that. Colossians chapter 3. Now I'm going to read this for you here to establish the roles and operations for the headship, the helpmate, and the offspring or the children. Then we're going to go and look at Ephesians where it's broke down. Colossians chapter 3, verse 18. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husband as it is fit in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and be not bitter against them. Children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well pleased unto the Lord. Fathers, provoke not your children unto anger, wrath, lest they be destroyed. So you see the structure again. Husbands is the head, wives, submit yourself unto them. Husbands, love your wives. Children, obey your parents. You got it? Now let's go to Ephesians. I sure hope y'all not just sitting there like, I hear what you're saying, but you know what? I ain't doing none of that. Okay, well, do what you do. That's why you're stuck and be broke, busted, and jacked up, and you're going to be wondering why you're sad and miserable. Because like I said, the Lord asked me the question, do you want to be defend your position and be right, or do you want to be happy? Now, for a while, I want to be right. I said, I want to be right. I ain't going to lie. For a while, I want to be right. You ain't going to, But right wasn't getting me happy. I finally said, well, Lord, I want to be happy. Because I asked the men in the church, because I came off the street. I didn't grow up in church. Nobody taught me the Word of God. We didn't read no Bible in no Sunday school. So when I got in church, I went and asked the fellas that was there, been there longer than me, well, how you do this thing? They said, boy, you go home, you put your foot down, you wear the pants in your house, and you. And so I did that. I went home, kicked in the door. Look here, woman. I'm the man up in here. Now, I don't know nothing about what I'm saying, but I'm just saying it. It didn't work. It didn't work. I was trying to get on my platform, but I was going all about it wrong. And we battled. Because Quantrell just straight ahead, hey, wait just 1 second, you ain't my daddy. I know I ain't your daddy, but I'm the man in this house. I'm the boss. You ain't my boss. No, we went back and forth. That's why I come on when I listen to y'all, we done been there and done it. That's why I already know. It didn't work. So I had to go back to the Lord and say, well, Lord, this ain't working. He said, do you want to be right or do you want to be happy? I said, at this point, I want to be happy. Then here's how you do it, son. And this is when he started talking to me about this. Now, all these years later, I'm happy now. See, I don't have to insert my manhood now anymore. Why? The foundation's right. At first, I'm inserting my manhood. Why? Because everything was crumbling and falling down. Because I wasn't in place. Now, verse 21. I like how this starts. Most folks don't read verse 21. We're in Ephesians chapter 5. Most folks don't read verse 21 when they're teaching or talking about this. But if you leave out verse 21, the whole thing is messed up. I'm going to establish everything I've said so far. Verse 21, submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of the Lord. The Amplified Bible says here that be subject one to another of reverence of Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed One. In other words, he's saying here, husband and wife, submit to the anointing that I have placed on one another here. Submit to their operations and their functions. You're not more powerful than her, and she's not more powerful than you. You're equal. Submit to one another's anointing. There should be a giving and an exchange in the relationship. Amen. I'm submitting to the anointing on her. She's submitting to the anointing on me. The structure's in place, and it works. But the moment I begin to think that, hey, I'm big daddy here. You do what I say. I'm the boss here. See, I'm now minimizing her anointing. And it's going to cause a problem. Because there are things that her anointing does that mine doesn't. And then there are things that my anointing will do that hers won't. But when we submit to one another, it functions properly. Isn't that just like God? God gonna make sure you gonna need one another at the end of the day. You can't do it all by yourself. All right. 22. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husband as unto the Lord. Amplified, wives, be subject. Be submissive and adapt yourself to your own husband as a service unto the Lord. Now, wives, submit yourself to your husbands. That word submit does not mean obey. Your wife's not supposed to obey you. Because if Paul meant obey, then when he was speaking to the children, he used the word obey. When he gave out the responsibility later on about the kids, and we'll get there, chapter 6, he says, kids, you obey. He didn't use the word obey when he was talking to your wife. He used the word submit. The word submit means to willfully come under. Wives, submit yourselves to your husbands. Why? As a service unto me. In other words, right here, God's saying is, wives, you're just as strong, just as capable, just as knowledgeable as your husband is, but I've made him the head. And in order for this thing to work, I need for you to submit to him. Do it for me. It says, as unto the Lord, do it for me. See, you're not doing it because your husband says so. No, you're doing it as a service unto the Lord. Lord, Father, thank you. I know who I am. I'm comfortable in my skin underneath the anointing that you've anointed me with, and I know who I am in my anointing. And I'm going to submit to this man, not because of what he did it right or he's doing it wrong or whatever, but because you asked me to, as a service unto the Lord. Submit. Why? Because that's the position. That's the position. It's going to benefit you. Well, it just seems like I'm going to end up being a servant, being somebody's slave. I'm going to have to obey everything. It's not what he said. You go back over in Proverbs and read where he talks about that virtuous woman. That woman was an entrepreneur, a business owner, had employees, but she functioned in her anointing and functioned on her platform in her anointing with all that going on, and it worked properly because the Bible says that there was honor on that house. They honored that man. They honored that family. They talked about that lady. She did all of that on her platform. Why? The anointing will move when you're where you're supposed to be. He only gave one verse of scripture to the woman. Submit to your husband as a service unto me. That's all he said. That's all, ladies, that's all you have to do in the family is submit to the head. Well, Pastor, I don't have a husband. I've already told you the Word of God said that he will be your husband. Jesus says, I'll be your husband till one shows up. So you're never supposed to climb up on that platform. If you don't have a husband, submit to the Lord. Let him lead. Let him give you direction in prayer. Let him tell you how to run your family and stay on your platform in your anointing. It'll work. But if you try to climb up there, you're going to end up losing because you're not equipped to stay. It's not your platform. One scripture he gave to the women. Think about that. Because I was reading this the other day, and the Lord just told me this yesterday, no, Friday. I said, well, Lord, why you only told the lady to do one thing? And then I keep on reading. It's like all these scriptures to the man. One less scripture to the lady. Submit to your husband as a service unto me. And then all the rest of it, chapter 5, is to the man. The Lord says, because I wanted to make sure that that man understands how not to abuse the position. It's so important. It carries so much weight. But how to operate in it without being abusive. And I want to make sure that I clarified every single component to the responsibility so that he understood when it's all said and done, you're not to abuse your authority. Now let's look at it. Verse 23. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church and the Savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be subject to her husband in everything. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. So he's already told the woman that you give yourself in submission to your husband. But notice what he's telling the husband. You give yourself for your wife. It's a relationship of giving. See, here's the proper balance. Husbands, you are to love your wives as Christ loves the church. So that's saying that I have to love Quantrell to operate with Quantrell as Christ operates with me. Did Jesus beat you over the head and make you do something? Does Jesus always point out your error? You ain't no good. See, can't do nothing right. Can't cook the food right. Can't bake the bread right. The clothes all jacked. Is that what Jesus, does Jesus come point out every sin you've ever done? The Bible says he does what? He covers them and takes them to himself. He assumed the responsibility for you. Right? Husbands, what are you assuming for your family? See, I got to love my wife as Christ loved the church, and I got to give myself. In other words, I got to lay down my agenda and pick up the agenda for my family. See, the reason that husbands, I'm talking to you this morning, the reason that you can't get your house straight is because you're too busy stuck on stupid trying to be you. And I know I'm saying some stuff strong this morning, but it need to be said. You're selfish. It's all about me, what I want, when I want it, how I want it, and I don't want to lay nothing down. When the scripture says you're supposed to lay it down like Christ laid down for you. If you didn't want a wife and kids, you shouldn't have gotten married. But now that you're married, you have a responsibility. You are the head of that family. And to lead that family, I got to lay my agenda down, and I got to go to the Lord and get the one for my family and submit and bring my family under that one. And I can't do it browbeating my whole house. I'm going to do it in prayer. I'm going to do it living the word. I'm going to do it being an example. I'm not going to send my kids to church. I'm going to bring them. I'm not going to tell my kids to pray. They're going to see me praying. I'm going to lead them in prayer. I'm not going to tell my kids what's right or wrong. I'm going to be the example of right and wrong in front of them. See, I can't tell my kids, don't do that, and then they see me do it. I can't tell my wife what's all wrong in her life, and I understand. Well, just one second. If the foundation, if the house is falling apart, it's not the house's fault. It's the foundation's fault. Because God put you there, foundation. Get it right. See, you want to make excuses. You sound just like Adam. It's this woman thou gave me. And God said, you're lying. It was you. Woman, it had nothing to do with it. You didn't do your job. He says, and you give yourself like Christ gave himself for his bride. Give yourself. Lay your agenda down. Lay your selfishness down. Quit trying to do it your way and get what you need and get all that you need out of the relationship, and who cares the hell everybody else. That is the most selfish attitude as you can take. And selfish attitudes and selfishness is 100% characteristics of Satan. Read your Bible. Says you give yourself for your wife, your family. I can't tell you how many things I wanted to do that I chucked out the window when I got married and found this out. All that stuff, hey, if I wanted to do it, didn't get it done before I got married, if it's going to interfere with God told me to do it with my family now, it's going to the back burner. Goodbye. Got to go. Because I'm going to build what God said build here. Because I'm going to be happy. Ain't no need of me being married and we're going to tough it out till the kids get over there and we're divorced. That's stupid. We're going to tough it out till the kids grow up. Well, you dumb, because all them years you tough it out, the devil's just robbing your kids. They ain't going to turn out right anyway. And you was unhappy for the last 15 years. Sleeping around, having affairs. You think this stuff ain't affecting the kids? Even though, see, your kids can be respectful and still respect you. Because they're not saying anything wrong. But that don't mean in their hearts and in their mind they have respect for you and they honor you. Because they see what you're doing to their mama.
That's true.
I don't care what you say. Absolutely. They may not ever say anything physically out of their mouth, but they see what you're doing to their mama. Because they see their mama's tears. They hear their mama's cries. They see that stuff. And you think that stuff's not affecting that house? Amen. And affecting them kids? You foolish. And they may smile and be respectful to you, but they, in their heart, they're hurting because they see their mama hurting and you doing it. Because you're too busy trying to do you. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loves the church and gave himself for it. He didn't blame the church for the problem. He says, okay, the church got a problem. I'm going to figure out how to get it solved. Father, how do we do this? Okay, all right, go to the cross. All right, got it. Came down here and hung on the cross and assumed responsibility for the church. He didn't blame them. So stop blaming your wives for everything wrong in the house. It's your fault. Pastor, that just ain't fair. I ain't trying to talk to you about fair this morning. I don't care nothing about fair. I'm talking to you about what's right. It's your fault. If you want fair, read a book, something. I don't know, go to the basketball game and the referee, fair or not. I don't know what you want, but when it comes to your family, we ain't talking about fair. We're talking about what's right. Amen. Amen. I come to the house about the other day talking to me and Quantrell about some stuff going on his job and his boss didn't want to be fair. I said, boy, shut up. I won't hear nothing about that. You grown. That's what kids talk about fair. Anybody care and worry about your fair? You better do what the word of God said do. Fair. Verse 26, here's why. That he, husband, might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of the water by the word. In other words, here's how you give yourself and love your wife. You correct everything in your house through by the word of God. Jesus cleansed the church by the washing of the water of the word. He lived the word, talked the word, responded to the word, performed the word for his bride. That is your job, to get in the prayer closet, to get before the word, to get the word in you, to learn how to operate in this word and be the man of your, be the head of your house. A person able to hear God, get a direction, and go to the family and say, here's what God said, and then the wife hears it, okay, I got it, and she goes to building. While she's building, what are you doing, husband? You stand there making sure the devil don't, you better not touch not one thing she builds.
Amen.
You standing up here because you the head, you got the headwind, you got the spiritual authority. If the wife's back here building and she's working with the family, she says, honey, I think something's out of order here. Something ain't right. Something's going wrong. Because she's back here doing the day-to-day operation. Something's wrong. Something's not right. I don't know what's going on. Step back up here. Oh, yeah. Father, something's going wrong in this house. What's the problem here? Is that what it is? All right. Devil, how dare you? But see, she can just keep right on building. Because he's doing his job in his anointing. She's doing her job in her anointing. And the kids are reaping all the benefits.
Right now.
There's a structure here, folks.
Thank you, Lord.
And it works. But with your mind stuck on this modern day idea of marriage, your stuff falling apart. You can't figure, you prop this side up, that side fall down. You prop that side up, that side fall down. Why? Because it's off, it's broke, it can't work, will never work. And you trying to figure out how to make it work, and it can't. And you end up with the same thing that the world gets, a divorce. Wayward kids. Let me finish it because I know I'm taking long. That he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of the word, water by the word. Why did he do that? That he may present it to himself, a glorious church, not having a spot, wrinkle, or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. All the blemishes that you see, husband, it's your fault. What are you in there doing? What are you washing? What are you using your faith to correct? So you point out all the mistakes, but you're not doing anything to correct any of it. All right, Pastor, I'm going to go home and I'm going to tell her. She's going to listen to what I'm saying. I'm going to kick like I try. See, I tried to come in here and do it, but I had it all wrong. That's not how Jesus did it. How does Jesus get his church to do anything? He loves them. And because we know he loves us, we're willing to do anything. When your wife knows without a shadow of a doubt, her man is standing on that platform and he's being all that he can be for this family, you better believe she got his back and she's back there doing what she need to do, and better not nothing and no one try to come in between that.
Amen.
See, when they're right, when each person is right, the other person got them. Because you don't want nobody tearing up what you got. See, that's why you don't need to be listening to your friend and all them. Hey, shut up. You go and do what you do at your house. You don't even like going home. And you telling me, oh, you spend too much time with your husband. You don't even like your husband. So why am I going to listen to you?
Amen.
See, you let folks tear up your families. Listen to all that crap mom and daddy told you. If mom and daddy didn't do it this way, you can truck all that. That's wrong. Get rid of it. If mom and daddy's not talking to you about what thus said the word of God, mom, I love you, but that's off limits. Don't need to hear that from you. Daddy, nah. And here's something else. Quit taking your trash to their house.
That's the truth now. That is the truth.
Stay out your mom and daddy's house with your trash.
Amen.
It ain't their fault. And then wives, they don't need you being mad at your husband. If don't climb up on his, hey, you get, I'm tired of you. We can't do nothing. I'm leading us out of here ourselves. See, you're doing it wrong. Nah, get in there and pray. Father, Daddy, now look, Daddy, this the man that you gave me. Did he get that? First of all, that's right. Did he give you that man? Let me ask you that. If he did, then I need for you to help him, Father. Because I need him to get on this platform, because we're tired of struggling here. Herein is the other reason why you don't marry an unsaved. You just don't make your own decisions. Let me tell you something. If the man is your head, hear this. If the man is your head, going to be the head of the family, right? And I've spent all this time talking about that. You should have that by now. The Word of God says that Christ has delivered you and I from the authority of darkness. That's where Satan domains, right? You've been delivered out of there. Why would you go and marry an unsaved man and put yourself right back under the headship of someone who's vulnerable to being led by the devil?
Amen. That is true.
Did you get that? Because that's what you're doing. He's vulnerable. He's not born again. There is no mechanism in there to keep the devil out. Now, you could have a saved man who's just being foolish, but there's a mechanism in there that you can go into prayer and God can yank that chain. But when there's no chain to yank, what? It's hard. Now, not only do you got to pray for him to get his position, you got to pray for him to get saved first. And you got to labor in that. And I suggest you use your faith and stay on your faith and stay strong in your faith. But I got to say this or I'll be derelict in my duty. And I'm not trying to tear anybody's faith down with this statement. All right? If you're in that predicament, I strongly suggest you stay in prayer, and I'm praying with you. Because you need a saved mate, man and woman, whoever you are. But folks, here's why God said, don't do it. You have no guarantee that that person will ever yield to the voice of the Lord because God can't make them. He can't make them. No such prayer, make my husband love me, make my wife love me. God can't make them. There got to be something. This is why I said you got to listen to the Lord down this path. It is so crucial. This is your future. Let me finish this, because I know I got to let y'all go. He said that he want to present it, a glorious church. So men also to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself, for no man ever hates his own flesh, but nourishes it and cherishes it, even as the Lord the church. For we are members of his body and of his flesh and of his bones. For this cause shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall join himself unto his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let every one of you be particular, so love his wife even as himself, and wives, see that you respect and reverence your husband. Now, what did all that just say? Husbands, here's the structure. You're the head, but you don't get to be the boss. Love your wives, cherish your wives, honor your wives, pray for your wives, be strong for your wives and your family. Wives, I know who you are. But I'm asking you to do me this service and submit to that man. He had a tough job. And he's going to need some prayer. He's going to need some support. Respect him. Don't disrespect him, respect him. Now to the last thing. The offspring. The offspring's responsibility. I didn't read this earlier, but like I said, I'm finishing this today. We're going to get it all right here. Let's go to Proverbs 22. Offspring, what are they anointed to do? and give you the whole picture, and we'll be done here. Proverbs 22. Verse 15 says, foolishness is bound in the heart of a child, but the rod of correction will drive it far from him. So, children, don't get mad because they do dumb stuff. That's what kids do. All right? Foolishness. That's what they do. But it says you get rid of the foolishness with the rod. Now, and if all you do is beat them, you still haven't done anything but beat them. Here's something else. Quit beating up on your kids for stuff they see you do. That's why I said all what I said earlier. Here, you got a 3-year-old in the mall, and y'all stand there, and all of a sudden, a 3-year-old start cussing like a sailor. And he, stop saying, what you mad at the 3-year-old for? They just heard you say that before you got out the car. You cussed out your husband before you went in the store. You called your wife a stupid blue, 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 blue before you left the house. And you mad at the kid. No. So don't be beating them for stuff that you do. But here, come on back over here. Verse 22, chapter 22. Verse 6, here's how you deal with, you need to use that rod. You spank butts. I don't know where we ever got off thinking that the kids can't get spankings and get their butts done. That's why they got the cushion back there. It's for spanking. Yes, it is. Got a kid right now. Found out I was related to her. Oh, Jesus. This girl spoiled. I know she's spoiled. I just see how she operated at school. And I'm like, Lord Jesus. I'm going to leave that there. Because they may be watching. But anyway, chapter verse 6, it says, train up a child in the way that they should go. And when they won't depart. You have to train foolishness out of a child. If all you're going to do is spank, you haven't completed the responsibility, your responsibility yet. You spank and train. You train first, then you spank, actually. Here's the expectation. Here's how the expectation should be done. And when you don't do the expectation, after a season of opportunity to perform the operation, and you continue to decide not to do it right, now it's time for the rod. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And after the rod, now let me explain this to you again. See, when I got ready to teach my kids how to clean up stuff, I didn't say go clean up the bathroom. She's sitting right quarters right there. Ah, that's not how I operate. No, we ain't, don't, no. All y'all get up. All y'all come stand right. You stand there. Did you see me wipe way down there and way down there at the very bottom? Do you see how I did that right there and how I did this? Do you see how this bathroom looks right now? So when I say come to the bathroom, that's how it should look. So when I send you in here next week and I come check it, that's what I need to see. See, that's training. And when I come back, now you know what the expectation is. Now, if we can't get that right, now we're going to do the other. But I'm wrong if I can't spank it and I haven't showed you anything. So you got to train. Children are anointed to learn. Offsprings are anointed to acquire knowledge from you. Whatever you teach them is what they will absorb. Yes. Yes. This is why I asked you yesterday and said to you that your children are arrows on a bow. Your decision is the bow that you put your arrow on. Will it be God's bow or will it be the world's bow? But they will go on one. So you have to train. And if you're not going to train them, then look at this. Proverbs chapter 4. Here's why you train them. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 1. Hear ye children, the instruction of a father, and attend to knowing understanding. For I give you good doctrine. Is the doctrine daddy's? Daddy's? You are the first trainer of the kids, daddies. It's not mama's job to come to church and learn, go teach the kids. That's your job. Mama's the what? Helpmate. What did you teach them? Mama helps influence or enforce. But if you taught nothing, they've learned nothing. For I give you good doctrine. Forsake ye not the law. For I was my father's son, tender and only beloved in the sight of my mother. He taught me also and said unto me, let thy heart retain my words, keep my commandments and live. So this is your future.
Yes.
Now, one last place. Go back to Ephesians. Daddies, you are the primary teacher in your house. I know that's not what the world says, but the world is wrong. If they was right, we would see better children right now.
Amen.
Kids have no respect for authority, don't even understand what authority looks like. Why? They've never seen it.
Amen.
Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and your mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it might be well with thee, and that they may live long upon the earth. And fathers, do not provoke not your children unto wrath, but bring them up in the nurturing and admiration of the Lord. The Amplified Bible says, do not anger your children, do not exasperate them to resentment. In other words, you don't browbeat them down and everything they do is wrong and you're stupid, you can't do anything right, and I'm just getting sick and tired of you, and you're just constantly harassing them. What's going on? It says all you're doing is bringing resentment and anger. You're teaching love. You teach out of love. You don't beat out of hatred and anger. You don't spank your kids out of hatred and anger. You do it out of love. Because I know if I don't deal with you, the Bible says whom he loves, he chastens. If I don't deal with you, then somebody out in the streets will, who don't care nothing about you. I would much rather deal with you than have the police officer have to shoot you, beat you over the head, or you walk up out here and I got to come off my job 6 times in a week. Because the school keep calling here because you can't sit down and be quiet at school. I don't have the time to go into all that I need to say. But here's why your homes are being spoiled. The structure's wrong. And while you may be thinking that this is 2016 and we ain't got to do all that, and we can be our own women, and we can do our own thing. And men, I don't need nobody, you know, I'm just gonna keep on doing what I do. This is why you're getting what you're getting. Folks, I'm telling you, this works. It works because God said it worked, but I can tell you it works through experience. There is a corporate structure for the family. I've given it to you this morning. I've walked you step through step of what it looks like and how it should operate. Now, if you'll take it and be serious about it, God will teach it to you. If you're in here and you're not married yet and you're thinking about being married and you take it and you start thinking about it, it'll help you understand what to look for. And once I get married, how to make my marriage work. Nobody comes preloaded with this wisdom. It is acquired. But after you acquire it, you got to ask the Lord, now you help me do this. And it's not easy because we're programmed to self-preserve. But you got to go against that worldly program of self-preservation. Because if you notice in the whole thing, there's a giving. Wives are submitting, that's a giving. Husbands are giving out of love. So there's a constant giving and the children are reaping all the benefits. And there's a change, there's a shift in that. While they're young, they're doing all, the children have a giving too, While they're young, they're doing all the receiving. But if you do it right, the day will come to where now the children have grown, matured, and understand, and now you're in a position where now the children have to give back to you.
Amen.
There's a responsibility that will come down the road for the children to be able to give to. So everybody in the whole corporate structure of the family has a responsibility. Now, what you going to do with it? What you going to do with it? That's the question. What you going to do with it? You going to keep on knocking your head on the same wall? Or are we going to keep on looking around and me and Quantrell got to sit down and do counsel over dumb stuff? Because I'm just going to be honest, some of the stuff that we hear in counsel, I'm like, this is stupid. It's just dumb. Because at the end of the day, all we're talking about is people protecting their positions. Who cares? Do you care about your family? Do you love your wife? Do you even care about your kids? Then, bruh, you're going to do something. Woman, do you want a happy house? Then quit beating this man down and respect him. Your mouth ain't saving, not changing nothing. I just read the scripture says a stupid woman tears it down with her own hands. Are you stupid? That's what I want to say. Are you stupid? Because you tearing it up. You don't need counseling. You need obedience to the word. That's what we need. And if we can get that and let God do his job and everybody get on their platforms and do what God said, it works, people. I don't have to protect me. I don't have to protect, well, if I give myself like that Quantrell, she's going to take advantage of me. I don't have to worry about that. It's not my job. Because oh my God. You know how I got right on my platform? It wasn't because I wanted to. I wanted to be happy, but I didn't know how. I got right because she prayed. She quit arguing, quit fussing, quit fighting, and she prayed. And God got on me. And when he got on me, see, she could have never gotten me to be right. Ever. I don't care, on her best day, she couldn't have ever gotten me right. I don't care what she did. But God knows how to get everybody and everything straight. Because God knows how to talk to you when you sleep. You can't get away from him. See, I can tune her out, click, and I've done it many times back in the day, and turn her off. And it's all I would see her mouth and didn't hear anything. Because I didn't care. Oh, she ain't gonna tell me what to do. She ain't my mama. Click. And could go 3 or 4 weeks, 3 or 4 months. Don't talk to me. I won't talk to you. That's fine. Walk right on past you like you ain't even there. Open the refrigerator up. And walk on. Easy. We had a full-size bed. Full. And we could sleep in it and never touch. No big deal. So I don't care what she did, it wasn't gonna fix me. But she started praying. I can't turn God off. I can't silence him. And he knows how to talk to me in a way that I understand. And when God got to talking, and when God got to read my mail, and one night laying in bed, God got to rolling a list of stuff out on me. And it was all right. And he rolled that list out. And at the end of the list, he says, now, if all this happened, I'm coming to talk to you. It's your fault. Well, my fault? Oh, Jesus. I got to get this right. Now, did I wake up the next day and do everything right? No. But I woke up the next day with a mindset saying, hey, we got to get this fixed, Lord. What? Hey, show me something. Tell me something. Show me how to do something. And God began to fix it. God began to get my mind straight. He began to give me the word. He began to shift me to the platform I should have been on. And I can tell you the day it happened. I can't tell you the actual date, but in my mind, I'm telling you. Because I wasn't on it. Quantrell was on the wrong platform. I was on the wrong platform. She was trying to make me submit. I was just refusing. been fighting the whole time. But the day I did this, I felt the responsibility of the family. I felt it. In the spirit, I got it. I know I got it. I should have had it the whole time. I never experienced that. I was like, oh, Jesus. It kind of scared me at first because I'm like, ooh, this is a lot. But I'm anointed to handle it. See, you never know what you're anointed to do until you put yourself in a position for that anointing to work. I was never in the position for the anointing to work for me to find out what I could do. But when I stepped over into the position and the responsibility of the family headship came, and it was like, God, this is what I felt like in the spirit. But then the anointing said, you can handle it. And he taught me what to do, and I stood right back up. Now I'm able to stand up. No, devil, no, you ain't running nothing around here. We're a saved house. I plead the blood on this house. Ain't no devil coming in here. You ain't touching nothing in here. You don't run nothing in here. And all the time I'm up here doing this, Contrails was back here doing this. And as long as she can stay back here and help, where that anointing functions at its best, the house got to where it gets to where it needs to get. This is why the old saying in the world came from this. If you find a strong man, a successful man, if you look back there, there's a wise woman back there. Amen. That's where it comes from. Because you're not going to find a successful man that's doing well and operating well and doing well and got a dumb wife back there. Dumb wife destroys doing well.
Amen.
Yes. I'm just saying. Now, this is no slant to anybody either. But you got a lot of brothers, and I need to say this. You got brothers, I want to get me a fine woman. I want all this, and I want everything. I want it fine. You sacrifice fine for a dumb as a box of rocks. Can't help you do nothing. But you got fine until you hit a problem.
Yep, that's true.
Now you in trouble, because fine can't help you. So when I was looking for, I didn't know, I wasn't looking for nothing. I had no idea what to look for. God was looking for me. Amen. But I thank God, God gave me fine and smart.
Amen.
Because I don't need fine without some smarts. Because when I look back there, I want to make sure, am I by myself? I got some help.
Amen.
Because fine what can't do nothing. No. After a while, she don't look that good no more. Now, nothing physically changed. You just got problems, and she don't look good. Every time I turn and ask for some help, you just... that ain't helping me. That ain't helping at all. Can I get another pair of shoes, another purse? That wouldn't... Another pair of... We got problems. You talking about shoes and purses? Nah. That's not what you're looking for, brothers. You're looking for an intelligent, smart, godly woman who got something going, can help. And ladies, this is why we be talking to you guys about get your stuff in order so that when a brother shows up, a real brother show up, not the one at the playground, but the real brother show up, mm-hmm. See, they recognize some stuff.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
See, I gotta stop. Quit trying to be sexy.
Come on now.
And be classy.
That's all right.
Amen.
Sexy didn't originate from God.
Amen.
When if all you are dependent on is your sexiness, then all you are appealing. See, when you step out there with your sexy, then what you are saying to it, what you're appealing to is the man's senses. So when all you get back is what he can see, feel, hear, taste, and touch, don't be mad. Because he wants to feel. And he wants to touch. Don't be mad. That's what you put out there. Sexy. You took your sex and made it appealing. So his senses can see your sex. You weren't classy. Classy puts a demand on, hey, well, just one second. Do you know who I am? See, a certain man, men that play in the playground, don't talk to classy women.
No.
They automatically know before they get there, she's out of my league.
That's right. That's right.
They don't even approach. Playground men only approach sexy, because that's what you're advertising. That'd be a little extra. For more CDs and tapes, you can see the website. All right, Father, we thank you this morning for your word. It's right. I know it's right. I don't care what nobody say. I don't care what nobody in this place say. I don't care what nobody on YouTube says. I don't care what the world says. You have a corporate structure for the family, and it works every single time. It'll work for whoever puts it into practice. And I give you praise for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, praise God. You've just got through watching the message about God's corporate structure of the family. And I know it's a wonderful message, a message that's truly blessed my life, and I'm sure it blessed yours. One of the desires I know of everybody that is married is to have a prosperous, healthy, and happy marriage. And one of the first steps towards doing it is understanding God's Word. When you understand God's Word and you apply God's Word to your life, it makes everything better. Now, one of the most important things that anyone can do when it comes to any relationship is to make sure that Jesus is at the center of it. And the only way that you can make sure that Jesus is at the center of your marriage is to make sure that Jesus is at the center of your life. Now, if you can't say that Jesus is at the center of your life, then let's take care of that right now. How about I lead you through this simple prayer? The prayer of salvation, and it goes like this. Just repeat this with me. Lord Jesus, come into my life. Be the Lord of my life and live in me. I renounce my past. I renounce sin. I accept you as my Lord and Savior. Take my life and make something of it. Now, if you've just prayed that prayer, you have become a member of God's family, and you have put yourself in a position for Jesus to become the center of every relationship that you have. Now, the next most important thing to getting Jesus and His Word to be the center of your life is to find a Word-teaching church and get in it. If you're here in the Kansas City area, we would like to invite you out here to Works of Faith Ministries. We're located at 12605 6th Street in Grandview, Missouri. It would be a privilege of ours to have you come out, and we will honestly teach you how to take the Word of God and make Jesus the center of your life. Now, once again, God is for marriage, and He wants to bless every marriage. So let the Word of God and let the blessing of God make your marriage like the garden place of Eden. Now, always remember that you are blessed and that you're highly favored of God. Amen.